He's the one.
The one?
The one who Moses foretold and the prophets said would come.
The one?
The one. Jesus of Nazareth, son of Joseph.
Nazareth.
Can anything good come out of Nazareth?
Come and see.
Oh.
Well, happy Palm Sunday, Liquid Church. Let's give a big welcome to all our locations. Happy Holy Week. You guys got your palms? Wave them in the air. Princeton, Passaic, Mountainside, Garwood, Somerset, Middlesex. So glad you're here. I'm Pastor Tim, and today does mark Palm Sunday, which is really the kickoff of Holy Week. In fact, did you know this? Right now, Christians, Christ followers all over the world, they are descending on Jerusalem, the capital city of Israel. Let me show you what it looks like. Thousands of pilgrims are gathering right now to commemorate the triumphal entry of Jesus into Jerusalem. And last May, Colleen and I took a group from our church to Jerusalem. We walked with hundreds of other followers of the way of Jesus down the Mount of Olives. That's the road Jesus traveled in on, riding on the back of a donkey. And every year, Christians from all over the world, they sing praise choruses, they wave palms, and they shout, Hosanna, God saves, Hosanna in the highest. Can you do that? Wave your branch, say, Hosanna, Hosanna in the highest. Our King is here, our Savior has come. Now, Palm Sunday kicks off Holy Week, which commemorates the last 7 days of Jesus' life as our Lord and Savior prepared to go to a cross to lay down his life as a sacrifice for sin, for my sin, your sin, out of love for you and me so we could be forgiven, redeemed, and receive eternal life from God. And this Friday is Good Friday. This is a holiday, not really, but you think of the word holiday, it means holy day, a holy day, where we remember the crucifixion of Jesus and his death at Golgotha. And I wanted to let you know how we're going to commemorate that as a church. Last year, Colleen asked me, she said, you know, honey, what are we doing for Good Friday? I said, well, let's do the usual. We're going to watch The Passion of the Christ, which is a little bit of a tradition in our house. Have you seen The Passion? Anybody? The Mel Gibson movie? Yeah, it's actually very bloody, very brutal, but it's also very powerful because you see the trials and the torture and the ridicule that Christ endured on his journey to the cross. And I like to watch The Passion once a year, typically on Good Friday. And you know why that is? Because even as a pastor, my heart needs a reminder that these aren't just stories we read from the Bible, that Jesus lived a real life in the real world, and he really loved me and gave himself for me. And that movie helps me just kind of connect viscerally with that. It gets my heart and mindset in the right place for Easter. And so Colleen said, you know, let's invite our friends to watch Passion with us. And you guys last year packed out Parsippany. So this Friday, March 29th, we're going to do it again at 7 o'clock, only we're expanding it to 4 campuses, okay? You can see Parsippany, Passaic, Princeton, or Mountainside. You can pick from any of those locations. And if you come at 7 o'clock, I want to let you know what to expect. It's a very simple, stripped-back service. There's no singing, there's no sermon, there's no childcare. What we do is three things. We are going to read the Passion account from the Bible, we're going to watch the movie, and then take communion together. We're going to remember Jesus' sacrifice. Starts at 7 o'clock, goes to about 9:30. And just a heads up for parents, this is a very, you know, brutal kind of bloody movie. It's rated R, actually, in the movies because it graphically depicts the historical violence of the cross. And so it's really not appropriate for kids under 15 or anybody sensitive to that sort of thing. And we're not having childcare. So parents, use your discernment, okay? We'd love to have you join us on Good Friday. And then I can't wait to preach live on Easter weekend. As you heard, we're hosting Easter services on both Saturday, that's a first for us, and Sunday at many campuses. And our Liquid family team, they are flying in a helicopter to drop 75,000 Easter eggs full of candy for the little ones. It's going to be a lot of fun. So invite everyone you know to our Easter services because I'm going to preach the paint off the walls, okay? We're going to talk about Jesus' resurrection because we celebrate an empty tomb, amen? Death couldn't hold Jesus and it won't hold you either. And that's what we're talking about today in the final message in our series, The Way. And this morning, Pastor Corey Daniels is going to be preaching God's Word. If you haven't met him, Pastor Corey is our young adults pastor, meaning he leads our 20-somethings ministry. It's called The Porch. And I believe Pastor Corey is a gifted voice for the next generation. So Liquid, would you give a big old warm welcome to Pastor Corey? Come on out, my man. Get ready to have some fun, buddy.
Yes, crush it. What's up, church? Oh, I'm excited. Hey, I got a phrase that I want you to commit to memory. All right, I want you to practice this in your car, practice it in the shower, practice it in the mirror. I need you to have this in the back pocket, ready to go at a moment's notice. Are you ready? It's three words. It's very simple. Don't overcomplicate it. It is come and see. Everybody say that with me. Come and see. Oh, yeah. When I first got to Jersey, this was about 14 years ago, I had friends that were like, seriously? Jersey? Why? Can anything good come out of Jersey? Okay, I'm glad you laughed, because I thought some of you were going to like throw something at me. You know what I told them? I was like, hey, listen, they got diners. Yeah, amen. They got real pizza. Yeah, we got Taylor ham or pork roll, whatever you call it. Where I'm from, all we have is Spam. It's gross. And you know what I told them? Ultimately, I realized, like, there's a lot of beauty here. And I said, hey, come and see. When Philip told his friend Nathaniel that he found the Messiah, he's like, hey, he's from Nazareth. They're like, seriously? Nazareth? Can anything good come from Nazareth? He's like, yeah. Come and see. You probably know people in your life, and they're like, seriously, church? Really? Can anything good come from church? It's sad, I get it. Your answer is simple. Come and see. Some of you are catching on, amen. And they're like, wait, really? I can come to church in sweatpants? I don't have to wear a suit? I don't have to be like prim and proper? You're like, yeah, come and see. And they're like, hold on a second. You guys are doing an Easter egg drop? Is that even legal? What does 75,000 eggs look like? You're like, it looks like chaos. Come and see. Oh, it's going to be amazing. And they're like, all right, what's the name of the church? They finally give in, right? And you're like, it's Liquid Church. Come on. And they're like, Liquid Church? That sounds like a cult. Are you in danger? Are you okay? Whoa. Blink three times if I need to call somebody for you. Don't you blink. Just say, come and see. Everybody say, come and see. Everybody turn to your neighbor, say, come and see. Turn to your second choice and say, don't make it weird. That's right. Yo, introverts all over New Jersey just disappeared in their seats. Amen. Hey, I got to tell you, I'm loving this resource, Reading the Gospel. Who's reading the Gospels this Lent series? Oh my gosh, let's hear it for our digital team. It's been amazing. Pastor Keon's got this like silky smooth voice. He could read about how to fix a dishwasher and I'll be like, in Jesus' name, I receive it. Pastor Kyra, girl, you got me rolling my R's. I go to my wife, I'm like, what's up, baby? She didn't laugh. She's like, you better stop it right now. She's done with it. But hey, this week, you're going to hear a story from the Read the Gospels. You didn't know you were going to laugh this much, did you? I didn't even know you were going to laugh this much. You're going to read a story from Luke chapter 19. It's a story about a man named Zacchaeus. You've probably heard this story before. And this is an unforgettable encounter he has with a man named Jesus, a personal invitation to come and see, and it completely changes his life. So everybody, let's open up our Bible apps to Luke chapter 19, starting right in verse 1. It says this, Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through, and a man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector, and he was wealthy. Now, if this story is new to you, what you need to know is that Zacchaeus was a Jew who was collecting taxes for the Romans. And the Romans were oppressing the Jews. So Zacchaeus was like lower than scum because he was getting rich off the backs of his people, the Jewish people. He was raising taxes, and then he was skimming off the top, and then he was sending those taxes back to Rome. So his LinkedIn profile might have said chief tax collector. But we all know that you can lie, right? Everybody who can read between the lines knows that his real title is dirty, lying, thieving, cheating, no good, son of a motherless dog. Nobody likes Zacchaeus. Everybody hated him. And you know what? He was a social outcast. He was a traitor. He didn't have friends. His family would have shunned him. He wouldn't have been welcome in synagogue. Y'all, he wouldn't have been welcome in church. But I want you to look at verse 3. It says he wanted to see who Jesus was. He wanted to see. He was at least a little bit curious. I'm willing to bet that he had heard about this dude named Matthew. If you remember from the Way part 1, we learned that Jesus invited Matthew. He said, come, follow me. And Matthew was a tax collector. So I'm willing to bet Zacchaeus knew just enough about Jesus that he needed to get this glimpse of this radical traveling teacher who hung out with sinners and outcasts, just like my man Zacchaeus. It probably all sounded too good to be true. And scripture goes on, it says, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. Where are my Gen Z at? They're probably still asleep, but yo, he was a short king. So he ran ahead and he climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. Now, if you've ever wondered what a sycamore fig tree looked like, here it is. It's massive. And this is actually really important, because if we travel back to the first book of the entire Bible, the book of Genesis, we see that fig leaves actually play a really important connection to this story. So I want you to pause really quickly in Luke. I want you to scroll all the way back up to Genesis chapter 3, verse 7. This is in the Garden of Eden, where Adam and Eve, they just ate from the fruit from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And it says in verse 7, at that moment their eyes were opened, and suddenly they felt shame at their nakedness. So they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. Man, Adam and Eve, they have fruit juice just dripping down from their chin. And they're like, oh crap, I'm naked. Which is everybody's worst nightmare, amen? I had a nightmare about that for this morning, last night, amen? Like, it's nobody wants that to happen. And I can't even imagine the awkwardness in this scenario. But what we learn from this scripture is that where there is sin, there's shame. And where there's shame, hear this, there is the human nature within us that tells us you should hide. It's this fight or flight mentality within us, right? And usually when we're faced with those two options, everybody chooses the latter. They choose to flight. They choose to hide. That's exactly what Adam and Eve do. Scripture goes on and says, so they sewed fig leaves together to cover themselves. Then when the cool evening breezes were blowing, the man and his wife heard the Lord God walking about in the garden. And so they hid from the Lord among the trees. Adam and Eve hid in shame. They covered themselves with fig leaves and they hid in the trees. Who does that sound like? Scroll back to the New Testament, back to the future, to Luke. Here we go. Zacchaeus also hid in a sycamore fig tree. What's my point? Zacchaeus wanted to see Jesus without being seen by Jesus. He was curious, but something inside him told him, hey, you need to hide. You need to hide, because he knows he's done wrong. He knows he's sinned. He knows he's not popular, but I'm also willing to bet he's not too sure about Jesus either. And if you don't know Jesus yet, I got to say, I understand the instinct to hide. It makes sense. So maybe you're sitting here today and you identify with Zacchaeus. You're like, hey, listen, I've had a difficult past. I'll admit, I've done some things, or things have been done to me. It's really hard for me to come and see, because I'm afraid that I'm going to be judged for my shortcomings. Or maybe you're intrigued, maybe you're curious, just enough about Jesus, but your brain can't quite comprehend the love of Jesus in and of itself, right? Because the love of Jesus defies human logic. You don't understand it, and you always fear what you don't understand. So how can you come and see if you're not even sure you're capable of believing? Zacchaeus wanted to see without being seen. And all of that changes when Jesus does the very last thing that anybody would expect. Scripture goes on. It says, when Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and he said, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I'm going to stay at your house today. And so Zacchaeus came down and he welcomed him gladly. Don't miss this detail, y'all. Notice what Jesus does. He stops and he calls Zacchaeus by name. This is probably the first time in a very long time that Zacchaeus actually heard his real name. Zacchaeus, instead of thief, instead of traitor, instead of trash, You can think of plenty of other colorful words. Don't act like you don't know what they are, Jersey. I've been to MetLife Stadium when the Eagles are in town. You know exactly what I'm talking about. But no, Jesus does the radical opposite. The radical opposite. Do you know what the name Zacchaeus means? Zacchaeus means pure and innocent. Pure and innocent. But hey, the audacity of Jesus to walk up to the most crooked man in town, stop at the base of the tree, look up and be like, Zacchaeus, bro, come down, man. Zacchaeus is probably like, stop saying my name. They're going to come after me. He's like, no. Come on down. Come on down. I see you not for what you've done. I see you for who you can become. Yeah. I see you not for what you've done. I see you for what you can become. By saying his real name, Jesus is peeling back the fig leaves. Jesus is giving him every reason to come out of hiding. I'm going to preach for a hot second, everybody, but here we go. Someone needs to hear this. Jesus does not fixate on your past. He focuses on your potential. Come on, Jesus doesn't fixate on your past. He sees you. He calls you by name, and he says, I see your potential. Who could you be? Who could you honestly be if you just turn from your ways and you follow the way of Jesus? He's calling you by name. He's calling you by name, and he says, hey, I see you not for what you've done, but I see you for what you can, in fact, become. Just follow me. Just follow me. And when Jesus sees sin, this is what's beautiful about it. He doesn't shy away. Many of us, we see sin and we're like, ugh, can't touch that. Jesus sees sin and he knows that the human nature is there and it's telling us to hide. And so what does he do? He leans in. He leans in. He calls Zacchaeus by name. And then he invites him to come closer. Based on everything that I know about Jesus, Jesus could have changed Zacchaeus' heart in the tree. In other words, Zacchaeus didn't need to come down. But Jesus is being super intentional when he says in verse 5, he says, hey, come down immediately. Immediately, y'all. There's urgency in the invitation. Jesus doesn't say, hey, Zacchaeus, you know what? Come down when you're good and ready. He doesn't say, come down when you stop stealing money from people. Jesus doesn't say, hey, fix your mess, get your life together, and then you and I can hang out. That's not what he says. He never puts a caveat before the invitation. He simply says, come down immediately. And then he invites Zacchaeus, he invites himself to Zacchaeus's house, which is a really bold move. People don't do that in Jersey, right? We call, and then we text, and then we call, and then we text three more times, and I'm like, hey, I'm in the driveway. Can you open your door for me? Yeah. Imagine really quick, Zacchaeus hops down from the tree. He's like, I'm gonna call my wife. Stand by. Hey, babe, what's up? Yeah. Hi. So good news, coming home. Remember that guy Jesus? Yeah, so he's coming over for dinner. Tonight. No. Listen, babe, I know it's date night. We can watch Reacher anytime. We'll catch up tomorrow. It's okay. No, listen, here's what I need you to do, okay? First of all, babe, stop cleaning. Stop cleaning. Don't do it. Just throw a charcuterie board together. Hold on, he's really Jewish. Skip the meats. Just skip the meats. Cheese, oil, bread. I'm going to order from Anthony Franco's. We'll be home in 5 minutes. I love you, babe. Please stop cleaning. Imagine, right? Am I the only one? I know. I see some guys who are like trying not to make eye contact with their wives right now. But because Jesus calls Zacchaeus down from the tree immediately, and then he invites himself over to Zacchaeus' house immediately, you got to understand that Jesus does not want you to present a fabricated version of what you think a perfect life is. He wants to meet you in your mess, and he wants to do it immediately. When you see that Jesus is, in fact, as good as advertised, then you respond like Zacchaeus. I want you to look really quickly in verse 6. It says, he welcomed him gladly. Gladly. Imagine that freedom in that moment. He heard his name for the first time without condemnation. He was seen for who he was, just as he was, and he's accepted and welcomed by Jesus. But there's a whole other part to this story that we got to tell. And that's the people in the crowd. They see this, and look what they say. All the people saw this, they began to mutter. He's going to be the guest of a sinner. Haters going to hate, right? Haters going to hate. Where are my T-Swift fans? I was going to sing, but I already auditioned for worship, and they said no, so I'm not going to sing today. But when Zacchaeus buddies up with Jesus, oh, y'all, that just triggers the crowd. They're like, are you kidding me? Remember fight or flight? They choose fight. Because they see that Jesus has chosen the one that they actually believe is unworthy. How do they respond? Anger and judgment. Got a question for you today. How would you honestly respond if Jesus chose a sinner like Zacchaeus over you? And I don't want to judge, because I got to confess, there's been times in my life where I have absolutely fallen short of this, where my heart posture has not been what it should be, where I look at somebody who is far from God, and I do not treat them consistent with what Jesus' teachings would ask me to. I used to work in a bar back in Pennsylvania. And I don't remember being super like outspoken about my faith, right? But like word got around, they knew that I was a Christian. So they started calling me Bible Boy. All of my coworkers, they were like, hey, Bible Boy, mozzarella sticks to table 12. Hey, Bible Boy, work quicker, work faster. Cleanliness is next to godliness. And I got like ketchup all over my clothes, right? Hey, Bible Boy. And this one guy in particular, he was a dishwasher. Nothing against dishwashers. They're important. But I walked into the kitchen one time. I had an armload of dishes, all right? I'm just trying to do like my best. And I put them down. And this dude takes the high-powered hose. You know what I'm talking about? The one with like the springs on it. It goes, and he sprays me in the face. And he's like, hey, Bible Boy, you need to be baptized. And if you've been around for a little while, you know that's not how it works. And the last person that you want to be baptized by is a dude that smells like old barbecue sauce and marijuana. Yeah, that guy was fun. And his older brother worked at the bar too. And the two of them together, oh, they were a joy to be around, y'all. So one time I walk out into the alley. They're outside smoking. And I bring this big bag of trash to take it to the dumpster. And I'm walking out there. And I don't know if you guys know this, but like, did you know that trash bags are flammable? I do now. The older brother pulled out his lighter, lit the bag on fire. This thing explodes. I'm a literal walking dumpster fire. And the trash is like all over the alley. The boys walk back inside. They're laughing. They're having their best life. I pick up the trash. I'm covered in trash. I throw it in the dumpster. I go back inside. And at this point, man, my blood is boiling. My fists are clenched. The vein is popping out of my neck. I'm grinding my teeth like I'm ready to go. And I absolutely would have hit him if it was a one-on-one fight. But I also realized that God did not give me a gift of physical intimidation. So I walked away. Boy, I gotta say this, y'all. Listen. I wish I would have hit him. Because what I actually did was so much worse. I walked away, fist clenched, angrier than ever. And I said, I'm gonna be real. I said, you know what would be awesome? Is if those two guys would just drop dead. Just drop dead. I wouldn't lose a wink of sleep. Now, I'm not proud of that. I realize that's not good. But you know what I told myself? I said, hey, it's okay. It's righteous anger. It's righteous anger. Are any of us actually worthy of Jesus? Absolutely not. Is it righteous anger from the crowd in Jericho? Maybe? Probably not. Can I get in your business just for a quick second? Let's get real, all right? When was the last time that you looked at somebody and you saw them as their sin, or you saw them as a mess, you saw them for what they did wrong, rather than looking at them and seeing them with a name, a human with an identity made in the image of God. When was the last time that you misrepresented Jesus? Same bar, different coworker. She came up to me, she said straight to my face, as casual and friendly as she could. She's like, "Hey, where do you go to church?" Do you know what I told her? I said, "You wouldn't know it even if I told you." It's not how this works. She gave me a golden opportunity to say, "Come and see." And I was like, "Nah." When was the last time that you talked with somebody, a door opened, to share your faith, to show them the love of Jesus, and you shied away? Or you misrepresented the teaching that we know in our heart that Jesus says is to go and to love? I got to be honest with you. I think sometimes we can forget what's at stake. Because guys, shout out to my parents for raising me in church, but I owe my soul to my college roommate who relentlessly invited me to church when I was this close to walking away from this faith. I was 18, 19 years old, and he's like, "No, you gotta come and see." So understand, that's what's at stake. It's not just community, it's not just songs, it's souls, it's eternity. That's what we're talking about here. Lives completely transformed by the love of Jesus. We say make heaven crowded, not by perfect people, but by imperfect people. Why? Because it doesn't matter what people think, it only matters what Jesus thinks. That's why in the story of Zacchaeus, the crowd knew his name, but called him by his sin. Jesus knew his sin, but called him by his name. Can I get an amen, somebody? Come on, I can't just be preaching to myself. Make some noise. Some of you, you got to be thankful for this, because God calls you by your name. He does not call you by your sin. He says, "I see you for who you are. I see you for your potential, not for your past." Guys, the radical love of Jesus, the radical grace of Jesus is life changing. My man Zacchaeus, he hears his name. And look what he does. He does a complete 180. Scripture goes on, it says, "But Zacchaeus stood up. And he said, 'Lord, look, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I've cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount.'" What did you do when Jesus called your name? Did you raise your hand? Did you pray a prayer? Did you get spontaneously baptized? Obviously not in a bar. But what did you do when Jesus calls your name? What does this guy do? He gives back half of his possessions. He's like, "Make it rain. My life has changed." He's headed in this direction. He hears his name, Zacchaeus. He stops. He turns. He goes the exact opposite direction. His idol is money. He worships money. He's a biblical Scrooge McDuck. He like jumps into money at the end of the day. But he's so radically wrecked in the heart. And he's so radically changed that he gives it all away. He gives it to Jesus and he says, "Hey, I'm gonna lay all that I have at your feet." Four times the amount. This is where I hear my mom say, "Actions speak louder than words." Amen? It's the radical love that leads to radical repentance. And then Jesus, he's like, "Hallelujah! This is amazing!" And he says to him, he's like, "Everybody check this out. Today, salvation has come to this house because this man too is a son of Abraham." Thank you. Yes. Come on, let's give a shout for that. This man too is a son of Abraham. You know what? The other day, he was being called a son of a you-know-what. Now he's a son of Abraham. He's got an identity. So wherever you are in your faith, maybe you're saved. Maybe you're a Christian. You're like, "Hey, I've been saved by grace." But you know what? I like to say sometimes you're seasoned by life. Or maybe you're somebody who you're like, "Oh, Jesus is coming." You'd be the first person to run out of Jericho. Whether you're a single parent in this room, and you're like, "I have nothing left to give. I'm exhausted. I see you." Or maybe you're an empty nester and you're like, "I don't know what my purpose is. I need a new purpose." And you're trying to figure that out for yourself. Can I talk to the teenagers in this room, or those of you who are in your 20s? There's rising rates of anxiety and there's rising rates of loneliness. And if you're sitting here and you're like, I don't think people see me. I don't think people hear me. If that's you, I'm sorry. Because I know the weight that comes from feeling like nobody cares. If you're an addict, and you're like, I'm so sick and tired of fighting off relapse after relapse after relapse, and you're burnt out, I see you. Or if you're a widow, and you're like, I got out of bed. Challenge accepted. Wherever you are, whatever you believe about Jesus, whatever you've experienced in your life, the pain that you've walked through, the wrongs that you did or the wrongs that were done to you, what I want you to know is you are never too messy for Jesus. Never too messy. You are never too lost. In fact, he's never going to stop seeking you anyway. Today, Jesus is inviting you like he did Zacchaeus. He wants you to come down. He wants you to come out of hiding. He wants you to peel back the fig leaves, reveal your true self. He's calling you by name. He wants you to come and see him. And I used to think then that this last line of scripture was specifically spoken to Zacchaeus, as if to be like, hey, and they all lived happily ever after. Now, the more I read this, the more I realize this is for our benefit. If we're going to follow the way of Jesus, if you were to ask Jesus, hey, Jesus, what's your mission? He'd be like, yo, it's simple. Check this out. He said, for the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost. The Son of Man came to seek and save the lost. He's like, I came to seek. I didn't come to sit back and kick my feet up and hope the people came and find me like some weird game of hide and seek. He said, hey, I came to seek. I'm going to go out of my way. That's why Jesus told this parable to his disciples. Matthew 18, it says, if a man has 100 sheep, you guys know this one, and one of them wanders away. Yeah, what will he do? Won't he leave the 99 others on the hills to go and search for the one who is lost? Sometimes to follow the way of Jesus, you need to go out of your way. Sometimes to follow the way of Jesus, you need to go and seek. Leave the 99 others to go and seek. And I don't mean to brag, but I have some very real life shepherding experience. I was famous for about 20 seconds back on Christmas Eve when I herded 2 sheep onto our stage. My family will never, ever let me live this down, y'all. But I was with these sheep for like 11 hours. That's a long time to spend with livestock. And look really quick. Look at the eye contact. We had a connection. I was their shepherd. And at one point, Libby, she bolts backstage right here in Parsippany. She bolted down the hallway toward the Liquid family rooms. So you can understand the panic that set in this moment, y'all. Because I'm like, yo, this is like the busiest Sunday that we've had. There's record number of kids, and this almost 300-pound sheep is going full Forrest Gump down the hallway, rage pooping as she goes. Yeah, I said it. You didn't know that was a thing, did you? Some of y'all don't have toddlers. Yeah, this sheep was rage pooping down the hall. And the funniest thing about this story is we had a security guy who was assigned to us. You've seen him on the hoverboards, right? He's on the hoverboard, and he's doing his best Paul Blart Mall Cop, trying to scoop the poop as I am chasing after this sheep. And my first thought is, you know what? This is not in my job description. And that's my broken response. I get that. You know, that's my human coming out. But the reality is that my second thought came from the Lord. And isn't it funny how that comes? Because the Holy Spirit said, you're right. It's not your job. It's your mission. It's not your job to chase a wanderer. It's your mission. It's not your job to go chase a lost sheep. It's, in fact, your mission. And how do we accomplish this mission? We try to keep it simple. One word. Relationships. Relationships. It's not a buzzword. Jesus modeled real, raw, authentic, sacrificial relationships. The kind of relationships that tick church people off. The kind of relationships with people who did not know him. The people that were far from him. So can I ask you this question? What's the name of somebody that God has put on your heart? What is the name of someone who is far from God, but they're close to you? Recently, I had an opportunity to connect with some friends from the porch. If you don't know what the porch is our young adult ministry. We host once a month gatherings. I have the best job in the world. It's a privilege that I get to host these. We have young adults that come from all of our campuses. They come together to connect. And I want to introduce you today to Preston and Nessa. They're two of our young adults. They're amazing. They were invited to church over and over again by friends, people that they had a relationship, friends that said, come and see. Check this out.
Growing up, I always had the religious part of the, you know, aspect of the church, but I never had the relationship part. So even though I believe in God, I never really felt connected. I never really felt his presence. I didn't know if I was living the right way that he wanted me to live. And so because of that, I was kind of just, I guess, pushing him away.
Growing up, I honestly had no background of faith. I was baptized when I was a baby, but it was just more just to do it. Getting into like freshman year, problems in my life got harder and I just didn't know how to handle them. Without faith, I just generally didn't see a purpose, didn't think I'm needed, didn't think I was meant to be born, just like all those like thoughts going through my head. After being invited to church and coming, and when worship came on, I never heard these songs before, but I'm just like reading the lyrics and I just started crying. Anyone will just pray for you if you ask, and like everyone's just here for each other. So many like friendships and connections I formed here. Like, it makes me feel like now, like, I'm not alone.
The Milsoms had been inviting us for a while, and then when we finally came, it was nothing like I'd ever really experienced before. Since coming to Liquid, I feel like everything is just completely 180. We started to come to the porch, too, and, you know, meet a lot of really nice people who are also very, you know, encouraging. And from that, we also got invited to join a small group. I definitely feel, like, a lot more connected now. To my friends out there who invited me, I just want to say thank you, you know, especially for being persistent, you know, because I didn't say yes right away, because that persistent love and effort is what really made me give it a try.
Thank you to my friends that invited me to Liquid, because you guys knew what I was going through, and instead of just trying to say it will be better, you guys asked me to come join your church, and you knew it would be the answer. And I just gotta say, it was the answer. And because of you guys, now I'm able to continue that chain. And now I try to invite people that are struggling and their lives are changing too. So thank you.
Yeah, let's hear it for Preston and Nessa. And more importantly, let's hear it for Ava and Eva and the Milton family for inviting them. Guys, this is amazing how God can move in your life and the ripple effects of lives changed by Christ leads to more life change. All because of an invitation, as simple as three words. What is it? Come and see. So my question is this: who's your Zacchaeus? Who's your Preston? Who's your Nessa? Honestly, who's your future Pastor Corey? Think of the names of these people. They don't know Jesus yet, but you know what? Even more powerfully, they know you. They know you. We have a really simple strategy here at Liquid. It's called invest and invite. Don't overthink it. Do not make it weird. Keep it simple. We invest in relationships with people who don't know Jesus. Unbelievers, neighbors, friends, family, whoever they are. We invest in those relationships. So are you ready? So we can invite them to come and see Jesus for themselves. And to make this easy for you, you may have already gotten this, but on your way out the door, we have these cards. This is your one-stop shop for Easter details. All you need to do is you need to go up to somebody and you say, hey, I love you. I really want you to come and see. Because you never know the difference that one invitation can make. And hey, we have these adorable cards then for your kids too. Seriously, they can write their friends' names on these cards and hand it to them. Isn't that amazing? It's like a little Easter Valentine. It's beautiful. They can be like, hey, come and see the Easter eggs rain down from the heavens. Who wouldn't want to say yes to that? Be honest. So my question is, who are you inviting to come and see next weekend? And for the record, I'm going to practice what I preach. right? My family, we have some people in our heart. We got some friends, Joey and Jesse, who just moved to the area. We've known them for years, and now they live like 10 minutes from us. We're going to invite them. We're going to be like, hey, you know what? Come and see. Love you guys. Then we'll play some board games after. My daughter, she just turned 5. She's got her friend from school named Kayla. She's the shortest, cutest little thing. My daughter wants to write her name down and say, come and see. And then my 2-year-old, he's my love warrior. He's in love with our babysitter. So we're going to invite Janae to come and see. Those are 4 names that God has placed on my heart. 4 names. Who's God placing on your heart? And did you know that behind the walls, behind the wooden planks, underneath the carpet, behind the drywall, in the beams, in the rooms around you, we have prayerfully written the names of people in our lives that we want to come and see Jesus. We've done this at every campus that we've ever remodeled. We've put names out there and we've said, God, this is who we need to come and see you and see your goodness. So really quick, just look around. Look around in the room at all of our campuses. Look around. This is holy ground. This is prayed over ground. Your name might be on the floor right beneath your feet. Your name might be right on the wall. You might be sitting here today all because someone took the risk to build a relationship with you and to invite you to come and see. And here you are, a testament to the faithfulness of those who God placed your name on their heart. Who is God putting on your heart? And right now, to end our time, we're going to carry on this tradition. At all of our campuses, we have these boards right here at the front of the stage, right at the altar. And we're going to take a moment. I'm going to call you forward in a moment. And you're going to come forward. You're going to pick up a Sharpie. And you're going to write down the names that God is speaking into you. Names like Joey and Jesse. I let Jesse beat me in every board game we ever play so that way I can ask her to come and see Jesus. Names like Kayla and names like Janae. She's too old for my son, but you know what? God's got a purpose for her. 4 names. 4 names. I know the Spirit's stirring in you. You're picturing faces right now. You're already thinking like, hey, I'm going to have this conversation. It might be a little bit awkward. It might be a little bit difficult, but you already know who you're going to invite, don't you? So at all of our campuses, I'm going to invite you to stand as an activation of our faith. Let's stand to our feet. And in a moment, when I finish praying, you're going to come forward at all of our campuses. You're going to pick up a Sharpie. You're going to write down the names as an activation of faith. Right here at the altar. Urgency, right? Come down immediately. That's what Jesus said. And the reality is this. The names, as much as I love these people, as much as you love those people, you know what? God loves them infinitely more. Would you pray with me? Let's hold our hands out to receive. I pray that the Spirit stirs. Father God, in the name of Jesus, thank you that you have called us by name. My prayer is simple as come and see. Lord, would you move in such a mighty way? You're already speaking the names, God. They're already on our hearts. Lord, I pray that we picture their faces in our minds right now. And Lord, in a minute, we're going to come forward. We're going to pick up a Sharpie. We're going to write down the name right here on the altar. We're committing it to you. Because we know, God, that your love erases a multitude of sins. That your love is the greatest thing on this earth. And I pray right now for everybody in this room, as they picture the faces of the people that they're going to write down. Lord, I pray that you would activate their faith boldly in such a way that New Jersey has never seen before. We are believing for resurrections this Easter. Not just the resurrection of Jesus, but resurrection, new life, simply because of a simple question. Would you come and see Jesus? Lord, would you stir in us? Holy Spirit, set a fire in us so we can live out this mission to go and seek. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. At all of our campuses, I want you to come forward now. Pick up a Sharpie. Write down these names. Activate your faith. He's got those names on your heart. picture their faces. God loves them infinitely more.
Thanks for watching the Liquid Church YouTube channel. Hey, don't stop here. I want to invite you to be part of our online community. Subscribe to this channel so you don't miss a single video or live stream. And share this with a friend. You know, everybody's welcome to join us. If you are blessed by this message, you can support our ministry by clicking the Give Now button to help us continue to reach people around the world for Christ. Thanks so much for watching. God bless.